Look at that. It's a new poster. In the last video, we talked about bards and their impacts on societies and society's impacts on them, but it may have been a little preemptive if your world is too premature to even have societies in the first place. So that's why I thought we'd take a step back today and talk about magic, which is a fundamental building block of any D&D world. Magic needs to have deep roots in D&D world building, so I thought we could use the sorcerer to take a look at the origins of magic. There's this fake scale that I like to use to compare the classes in D&D. I call it the character narrative scale, but basically on one end there's imagination, and on the other there's mechanics. Depending on where you are on the scale determines how much of your narrative is determined by imagination versus mechanics. For instance, the fighter for me goes way on the imagination end, because even with the same subclass and oftentimes the same feats and features and weapons, fighters' stories drastically differ from one another, and this is against a class like the wizard, who I'd put way on the mechanics end, because even though their stories can differ, when wizards often choose the same subclass and get the same features, their story tends to be pretty similar to one another. Every wizard has to use a spellbook and be educated and choose a specialization, so it's certainly the case that mechanics inform the story for the wizard. Sorcerers are in the middle, in what I would consider the sweet spot. At first level, they get to choose their subclass, which is the origins of their magical abilities. It's a really nice mechanic that guides the narrative, but the options within that choice is what makes things really imaginatively interesting. It's also worth noting that a sorcerer's power is innate. It doesn't necessarily have to be studied or learned, so they're really good guidelines for fundamental sources of magic. Here's an example. Maybe you chose to be a shadow sorcerer, so the origin of your magic comes from the Shadowfell itself. But what's the source in the Shadowfell? Maybe a dark mist rolled over your village one day, and you were transported to the Shadowfell and fell into a pool of lost souls, which imbued you with the power of the shadow. Or maybe you were a lost soul floating around the Shadowfell until a wandering mage or a nightwalker animated you, and some of that power still lingers within. Oh, or your mortal vessel is a rift between the planes, and every time you focus, shadowy magic comes through your hands and your eyes are vessels to the other plane. There are plenty of options, but this is the thesis of the video. Sorcerer's origins are perfect to act as fundamental sources of magic, determining where magic comes from in your world. The reason I love the imagination and mechanics mix of the sorcerer is because it grounds magic in a mechanical and tangible way, the mechanics, while also allowing magic to be weaved into your world and your narrative a little easier, the imagination. So here's the outline. 7 sorcerer subclasses each define their own source of magic in the world. When we go over them, we'll do 2 things. Provide scenarios where you can gain said innate magic, and ask what is the impact of this source on the world. Remember, each of these will now be treated as a fundamental building block of magic, which is a major focus of D&D. First up is the one that I find the easiest to fit in. Wild magic sorcerers are what I'll use to explain the way that I see sorcerers compared to the other classes. In D&D, there's this thing called the weave. I like to imagine it as a literal weave of raw magical energy that flexes and flows throughout the material plane. I imagine a wizard standing on the plane and casting spells mathematically to bend the weave into different shapes and rising energies. Sorcerers are like black holes for the weave. Their physical presence is an impact on the structure of the weave itself. That's a good start for wild magic. Volatile, living black holes pulling energy by tearing haphazardly at the raw stuff of the universe. Gaining power like this could just be a part of life, a chance to happen. It could be familial, or those born in wild magic portions of the weave gain the power. The impact would be interesting. It could have larger implications for the societal divisions between magic users. Wild magic sorcerers, or even sorcerers in general, could be seen as untamed threats, beings that are uncontrollable in power. So wild magic sorcerers set the groundwork for an ever-present well of magical energy that one either pulls from or manipulates to achieve their goals. Next we have Draconic Bloodline. A Draconic Bloodline sorcerer falls into one of 2 basic categories. Their dragon magic was gifted to them, or they are the descendant of a dragon. So let's ask, how is one gifted dragon magic? And does this mean that dragons are innately magic? Well, the gift could be ritualistic, something that involves dragon's blood or transmutation of some sort. Which ties in nicely to the answer to the second question, which is yes, dragons are innately magic for this to function as a genetic trait. Remember, dragons can shapeshift and are incredibly smart and live for hundreds of years. They have plenty of time to go find a mate that isn't another dragon, so it's entirely possible to be the offspring of a dragon that isn't half-dragon-esque or dragonborn. So, what's the impact? It could mean that dragons are a major source of arcane magic. That's what I opted for. When my homebrew setting went through a massively destructive magical reset, those that wished to relearn history and the ways of magic went to the dragons because they were always born of the arcane. It also makes it easy for dragons to be one of the first, if not the first, source of arcane magic. Who else better to teach ancient wizards the way of magic than dragons? Once again, that's why the base language of magic in my world is Draconic. It ties things together and makes these powerful creatures feel important in shaping history, especially considering the name Dungeons and Dragons. Divine Soul is another subclass that feels like a natural progression. A celestial or god chooses a vessel to place magic into. The impact is pretty clear. It can play with themes of religion and divine right. A power like this is gifted directly from a higher being, so these individuals are most likely seen as voices of reason, or even messiahs, within a religion. I think I'll do an entire video on religion, because I find it's largely neglected despite its obvious possible influence on fantasy societies. For now, it's just important to note that gods are a source of magic, so that adds another fundamental to our list. Storm sorcery is a little strange and a bit specific. It feels attuned to nature and has ties to the elemental planes, specifically the elemental plane of air. According to the subclass itself, its origins are typically tied to an event called the Great Rain. I don't find that entirely helpful, though, so I decided to rework it a little and make the elemental planes themselves sources of elemental energy. So rather than use the high technical skill to manipulate the weave into specific elements, a sorcerer can pull from this planar source of energy naturally. Not only does this work for the Storm Sorcerer, but it also easily connects content like the Pyromancer from Kaladesh, or the really old Stone Sorcerer back in Unearthed Arcana 29. Anyway, children of elementals could probably get this power passed down, but I also see it as an interesting opportunity to give sorcery through natural means. One of my favorite characters that I designed was Eos, an Arakocra that was soaring through the sky in a storm and was struck by terrible lightning. It granted him the ability to manipulate elemental magic. I find the idea that small elemental events being energy leaks from other planes really interesting. Those spontaneous fires or terrible storms could contaminate those close by with elemental magic. As for impact, this one is down to specifics. If some weather events have these causes, perhaps there is a way to track them or harness their potential. I talked a lot about this one so far, but I think it's time to add it to the list and move on. I spoke about Shadow Sorcerer examples before, so let's talk about the source and the impact. In older editions, the Shadow Weave existed as a dark version of the normal weave. In the 5th edition, it apparently doesn't exist anymore or something, so if you're sticking directly to the Forgotten Realms lore, then the Shadow Sorcerer is a strange addition. It implies the Shadowfell is inherently magic and may or may not have a connection to the normal weave. Apparently one uses the weave to connect to the Shadowfell and pull something from a plane of shadow. I give up. I'm not going by Forgotten Realms lore because I find it messy in this case, so I just assume the Shadow Weave continues to exist. Narratively, it makes for much stronger world building too. Imagine being enticed to tap into the Shadow Weave to cast magic for its different properties. Maybe all spells have dark alternates when their energy is fueled using this other source. Regardless, I like the idea that Shadow Sorcerers have some kind of inherent ability to use the Shadow Weave rather than the normal weave. As for impact, this one is big depending on how far you go. Does using the Shadow Weave to cast spells impact the spell itself? Not just sorcerers, but all spellcasters. Will these types of sorcerers be studied or feared or shunned? I really like the idea of this new source having new impacts on spells. I imagine it as one of those cool fire experiments you would do in chemistry where fueling the fire with different sources produces different results. After talking about this, I definitely need to go more in depth on this shadow magic idea. I think I'll make another video or a themed Patreon pack, so stay tuned. Alright, Clockwork Soul it is. I'm gonna be honest, I don't like the backstory that D&D provides for this subclass. I'm not a fan of Modrons. I don't like Mechanus or the Plane of Order because I don't know what that entails. Sorcerers can get their powers from being descendants of Modrons, which means, like dragons, Modrons are inherently magic. But who wants to be the descendant of this? I came up with something that works better for the consistency of my world, so I'm sorry if it doesn't gel completely with yours, but it's not that bad. Basically, wild magic sorcerers tap into the weave directly and have a direct destructive manner of interaction. When you tear at raw magic, expect some extra results if you use too much energy or malform the weave in a certain spot. Rather than be discordant with the flow of magic, imagine being that black hole on the weave that ebbs and flows with the energy of magic itself. Clockwork soul sorcerers reinforce rather than destroy. There's no randomness or chaos because this sorcerer's presence maintains the orderly structure of the weave. The implications of this are more appealing to me. The idea that there are creatures that are basically a part of the weave makes sense to me, but it shouldn't always be destructive. Becoming a clockwork soul sorcerer is most likely the same as becoming a wild magic sorcerer. You have a deep-rooted connection to the weave where magic flows through you, just differently. Okay, so down to the odd one of the bunch that haunts the nightmares of D&D world builders, the aberrant mind. It's not the subclass, but the implications. Allow me to read the first two sentences and then freak out. An alien influence has wrapped its tendrils around your mind, giving you psionic power. You can now touch others' minds with that power and alter the world around you by using it to control the magical energy of the multiverse. It's at this moment you need to decide how psionics work in your world. Because apparently, the lore of this subclass makes magic and psionics two separate things. Let's look back at those sentences. The psionic powers do two things. One, directly interact with the minds of others, and two, control magic by using psionics. It makes it seem like psionics are manipulating magic rather than psionics being magic. Honestly, it's not that bad. It just means that you have to spend some time thinking about the differences between psionics and magic and then realize in this instance for the subclass it doesn't matter a ton because most of the time you'll be using psionics to manipulate the weave to produce magic. I think. Whatever. Let's talk about sources. Tasha's Cauldron actually provides origins of psionic powers. Most have to do with creatures that already have psionic powers, like an Aboleth or a Mind Flayer, mentally attacking you, somehow leaving a scar in the form of minor psychic ability. We already kind of talked about implications. This means that psionics might need to be fleshed out a little more, and with things like Psy Warrior or Soul Knife also existing, it might be time to get a good grasp on what that means. So, small recap. There's the Weave. It's a source of raw magic that most users tap into to cast their spells. The wild magic and clockwork sorcerers have direct integration into the weave, which makes them kind of like black holes, or at least points within gravity, on this grid of magic. There's also the shadow weave, which is where the shadow sorcerers pull from. They could also be like the wild magic or clockwork sorcerers, or maybe just have some innate ability to pull from the source due to an event. The elemental planes are separate motes of elemental energy. The Storm Sorcerer pulls from the elemental plane of air. The Draconic Bloodline, Aberrant Mind, and Divine Soul each have innate power from some sort of gift or ancestry that allows them to naturally manipulate the weave rather than be directly tapped in.
We did it. We found sources of magic for you to use in your world that make sense and are grounded in the sorcerer subclasses, and now sorcerers in your world come pre-built with imaginary and mechanical aspects that make them complex and lore-rich, but not too outlandish. As always, thanks for watching. We release themed homebrew packs bi-weekly on Patreon, and if you like the video, please consider subscribing as it really helps us early on. Thank you.